Okay. So I'll speak to you for a few minutes about the rule of law and its relationship to the current kinds of conflict and violence patterns that Dr. Williams just spoke about. I'll speak for a few minutes at first on what the rule of law is and the status of rule of law in Africa. And then we'll come back to the question of how rule of law responses to these kinds of violence might be useful for managing or preventing conflict. So first, what is the rule of law? The shorthand version is this idea that nobody is above the law, including the people who are governing. And often rule of law gets contrasted with rule by law, which refers to a situation in which those in power are using the law to constrain the behavior of others, but maybe not the behavior of themselves, right? So that's the shorthand version. Rule of law prevails when there's a widespread sense that everyone is subject to the same rules of the game, including the president, the security forces, and other state actors, and when there are mechanisms in place to make that principle real for everybody. So in effect, there are ways for the government to protect citizens, but also there are ways for citizens to hold government officials and other citizens to account when they aren't following the rules. So that's the basic idea. I think if you look around at different entities that are working on the rule of law, I have found the definition from the World Justice Project pictured here in the infographic to be particularly helpful. They provide a general definition of what are the ingredients of rule of law. This includes accountability for the government and for private actors underneath the law, a set of just laws that are clear about what the rules are, open government, so the processes by which those laws are enacted and administered and enforced are accessible, fair, and efficient for people. And then the fourth really important ingredient is accessible and impartial forms of dispute resolution. So at its best, this means rule of law involves institutions with checks and balances, laws and policies that are consistent and clear, equal protection of freedoms and liberties for everybody, and access to fair and affordable justice. Rule of law, therefore, has a profound impact on how the state relates to society, right? Rule of law, I also think, could be of particular strategic interest to security actors who are attempting to take actions that they want the populace to support or accept. It's very much, rule of law is very much shaped by people's everyday interactions with state officials, whether those are military officials, police people, courts, or people working for other parts of the state. And when there's mutual respect, accountability, and transparency in the security forces' everyday relationships with citizens, then there's a greater likelihood that the populace will trust state institutions. And that could also lead to a greater sense that those institutions are legitimate, coming back to our legitimacy and accountability theme that cross-cuts the course. And in turn, when you have greater widespread trust in security and justice institutions, people are assigning legitimacy to the police, the military, the courts, then perhaps these institutions can also become more effective in preventing crisis and in deterring violence. So that's sort of the process with the arrows that I've pictured here on the slide. All right, so given that that's what we're talking about when we talk about the rule of law, what is the state of rule of law now in African countries? I'll just give you a small snapshot and sort of a continent-wide look through, again, three different data sources that are particularly useful that I think you might find helpful in the work that you're doing. Rule of law, I will start by saying, does not have a rich tradition of being studied in a very data-driven way like we've seen with the conflict and violence data sets that Paul showed us. But there are beginning to be some core sources that we can reference to get a general sense of what's going on. So here are three that I really like and I think will be useful for you. The first is the World Justice Project. Now, they do an annual World Justice Index, a Justice Index, and they provide scores for 126 different countries in the world. And they do annual analysis of the state of rule of law in different countries. They look across many domains. So here, rule of law is defined very broadly. Constraints on government powers. Is there an absence of corruption? Is there open government? Are fundamental rights protected? Is there order and security? Is there regulatory enforcement? And are there civil and criminal justice institutions in place that really help the cogs and the machine move in terms of getting justice for ordinary people? So out of the 126 countries ranked last year by the World Justice Project, Africa's top performers were Namibia, Mauritius, Rwanda, Botswana, and Ghana. So we've got Namibia, Botswana, Ghana up here in West Africa, among others, and Rwanda. As you'll notice, for those of you who know a bit about these countries, these, with the exception of Rwanda, tend to be established democracies. They also tend to be countries that are not immediately coming out of a conflict, so they're not particularly fragile states. Some of the bottom performers on this index were the Democratic Republic of Congo, Cameroon, and quite a few different countries, including Cameroon, but beyond, that are dealing with violent extremist threats today. So Mali, Niger, and Mozambique also don't score particularly high on the index. So it gives you a sense already that fragility and conflict are, of course, correlated with these scores on the rule of law that you might look at. Okay, a second source that's really useful in a different way is the Ibrahim Index of African Governance. And this looks, rather than at a country's score in a particular year, it looks at change over time in patterns of rule of law over the last 5 or 10 years. And we see here for Africa, the average rule of law score has improved over time. And in fact, the foundation, the Ibrahim Foundation, calculates that 2/3 of the African population lives in countries that have seen some sort of improvement in the rule of law when we're scoring it as the following things: having a mechanism for the orderly transfer of power, having an independent judiciary with clear laws and processes, having access to justice available for all, and protection of property rights. So that's a more circumscribed way of defining this concept of the rule of law than compared to the World Justice Index. This doesn't include, the Ibrahim Index has separate scores for human rights protections in different countries, people's exposure to violence in its various forms, whether through protests or civil war, violent extremism, and they have a separate score for the transparency of government more generally. So given that those things are being scored separately from the rule of law, particularly if you look at the transparency and accountability scores for African governments, things don't look quite as rosy as what we see when we look at rule of law, as measured here. And a final source that's critically important is the Afrobarometer. This is a citizen perception survey, so a household survey where people go door to door talking to ordinary people in 36 different African countries. The Afrobarometer happens in waves. It's done by African enumerators. And lots of different questions are asked to people, including quite a few that have to do with rule of law and justice. So we don't have some sort of aggregate set of information about all 36 countries, rule of law in each place that's been surveyed, but we can compare two recent studies that have come out through the barometer on rule of law. One is about Ghana, which again is a very established democracy, not particularly post-conflict or conflict-affected country right now, and Uganda, which is a bit more autocratic. And the same questions on the survey were asked in both places. And you get a sense, even comparing a democracy and a more autocratic spot on the continent right now, citizens in general tend to affirm on this survey the legitimacy of the police as an institution, the legitimacy of courts as state institutions. And so when people are asked, do police have the right to make people obey the law? Or do the courts have the right to make decisions that leaders and other people need to respect? People are generally quite affirmative in the 8 or 9 out of 10 range in terms of people saying, I very much agree with that statement. But if you ask, as the survey does, what people's actual levels of trust in some of these institutions might be, or you ask about whether they think the law is being applied unevenly, so it's not the same rules of the game for everyone, you also get significant perceptions by citizens that making rule of law real is still an issue. All right, so finally, what roles can rule of law and justice play in addressing the drivers of conflict and political violence? Rule of law, at its core, I would say, is about equality and inclusiveness. It's about everyone being subject to the same rules of the game. And it's about everyone being stakeholders in a governance process. And so thinking about these issues of equality, inclusion, and justice are really important, especially given the nature of some of these changing trends in violence that Dr. Williams spoke about. For example, I missed that slide. Let me just set it there. Rule of law issues are drivers of some of the major African security issues of the day. So for example, some of the core drivers of violent extremism, studies have found by UNDP and International Alert, looking at the Sahel, looking at Nigeria, that state-perpetrated human rights abuses and people's perceptions of the way the state is behaving towards its citizens are key push factors that play into why violent extremism continues to be a phenomenon in that region of the continent. There are other studies that show that civil wars tend to recur in places where there isn't as much accountability or transparency. Inclusive decision making is associated with longer and more durable peace agreements in quite a few cases across the continent. And countries in which state actors are engaging in things like torture, political imprisonment, forced disappearance, or extrajudicial killing, those countries have also been found in a recent study by the World Bank and the UN to be more prone to conflict. Protests, which have become increasingly common in Africa, are often motivated by, in part, by grievances that are related to social and economic exclusion. Social and economic exclusion is a key issue that a rule of law approach to preventing conflict or to managing it would take into account. And fragility, of course, also exacerbates some of these latent social and economic grievances about exclusion that can also contribute to pushing people towards violence as part of that recipe that Dr. Williams was talking about. So I think that we see across different forms of conflict, some of the key drivers or push factors do relate to rule of law and thinking creatively about how to use rule of law as a concept in devising approaches to dealing with this or helping our African partners address some of these issues could be key. So to conclude on the most general level, I think we can help mitigate and prevent security challenges in Africa by addressing two big picture rule of law challenges. First challenge is that people, and state security forces in particular, should be unable to enjoy impunity for their actions. So that's one big challenge, impunity. The other is ensuring that justice institutions are available and accessible to everybody, and that they don't operate on the basis of bias or uneven application of standards. I think that paying attention to impunity itself, but also bias, is very important. Perceived and lived experiences of both of those things can fuel the grievances that often facilitate radicalization, and they can also reinforce these patterns of social and economic exclusion that have been known to amplify the appeal of prolonging a conflict, and that have also at times created conditions for transnational organized crime to take root on the continent. I'll end by saying prevention frameworks are now at the frontier of dealing with conflict and violence. The World Bank and the United Nations flagship 2018 Pathways for Peace study recommended a couple of different rule of law approaches for dealing with conflict. So some examples that they've suggested: improving the accountability of security forces to citizens, engaging in stronger community policing approaches, and improving court efficiency so that justice is faster and more accessible to everyone. And this, you know, conventional warfighting tactics no longer suffice because there are many kinds of conflict that is not playing out today on the battlefield or through battlefield campaigns. And some of the armed actors that we're dealing with do not have clearly articulated end goals. So I think this prevention approach is really apropos of some of these developments. At the same time that we need an ever more preventive and human rights sensitive approach to ensuring security, African governments are also confronted with really complex sets of armed actors, not just insurgents, also terrorists and organized criminals. And this too requires increased sort of technical actions, better cross-border collaboration that would be facilitated by things like mutual legal assistance or intelligence sharing. But that can, of course, always be challenging and difficult on the diplomatic level. And it also may require careful interagency collaboration between the military, the police, judicial actors to help stop terrorists and organized criminals, collect proper evidence, make sure that detention standards are up to sort of the human rights standards that countries have signed on to, and then make sure that the justice system is working. So human rights work is important, but criminal justice collaboration is equally key, I think, in this new environment. Thanks.